Good morning, dear church. I invite all of you to stand as we begin our worship service this morning. And I'll begin reading the first verse of the Psalm 88 that says, O Lord, the God who saves me, day and night I cry out before you. May my prayer come before you. Turn your ear to my cry. May our Lord find ourselves crying to Him, asking for Him, asking for His presence, day and night.
Sunset sky, but my one request, but my only aim is that you reign in me again. Yeah, 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 yeah. Over all the earth, you reign on high, every mountain stream, every sunset sky. My one request, Lord, my only aim is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord over all I am. So won't you reign?
Seated. Our congregational prayer this morning comes from Galatians 2:16. I'll read the first verse and ask you to read the second part of the first verse. Knowing that a man is not justified by works of the law, but by faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ so that we may be justified by faith of Christ and not by works of the law. Here's just some key ideas and words to pray. Praise God for the faith of Christ and his good standing before the Father. Confess or admit any boasting of your own good works as justification before God. Ask God for the rest and joy that comes from believing his promises. Will you take the next 2 minutes just to pray silently in your seats, and then I'll close us with a word of prayer together. Father, Lord God, we just thank you once again to come together to worship you, to praise you, to encourage one another with the hope of the gospel, that we're made right by the works of Christ alone, by his life, death, and resurrection, that our justification with you is based on the work of Christ, not in any good works or any things that we perform, our religious deeds, activities, but solely on what Christ has done through faith alone. Lord, we ask that you would just forgive us of trusting in our own works or our own reasons to be justified before you and look solely to Christ and to cling to Christ. May we experience the joy and the hope of believing in Christ, of understanding that we have a relationship restored to you, that we're right with you, that we have peace with you through our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us to share this message with others. Help us to cling to your promises, to trust in your promises, to have hope in what Christ has done and the sure assurance of our salvation based on the work of Christ. Help us to cling to your truth. Lord, change us, transform us, open our hearts and our minds to understand your word this morning. Empower Pastor Craig as he brings the word. Teach us from your word this morning, and may you be glorified and exalted. May Christ be lifted high. We ask all this in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Standing on the promise of the Christ, my King, through eternal ages let his praises sing. Glory in the highest, I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God.
Please be seated. The question this morning is, where do you stand? So many issues out there. Where do you stand? Can you say this morning, Pastor, I'm standing on the promises of God. Pastor Craig here. Thank you, Pastor Rodrigo and team. Amazing. I had to take a picture of all you guys up there. Great to see all the instruments. Great to see Joaquin playing the bass. Wonderful. Welcome, everybody. Some of you guys are outside. Some of you guys are inside. Some of you guys are live on screen. And some of you maybe have been watching this posted at a later date. The Union Church 137 years in a couple weeks, July 4th, another birthday. And we're going to celebrate that birthday on the third Sunday. We won't make a big deal of it. We kind of wait for every 5 years. I think we're around 137 or something like that. 137 years standing on the promises of God. We're a Bible-based international church, so we use English as a tool, as an oasis, to be an oasis for those who are away from home, who maybe don't have Portuguese or can't worship in a house of worship here because they don't have the language. Well, you can always, but it's a lot easier when you can not only worship in a language you understand, but afterwards when you're talking and you need a hug, you can use the language from your heart. So English is a tool that brings people together, but it is Christ who unites us. And that's because the Bible is our standard for life and for our faith, and that faith is in Christ. And that's why we stand on the Word of God, we stand on the rock. If we could take a look here, if you missed a service or want to watch any of our messages, you can go on YouTube or Facebook, Instagram, and just type in the words Union Church Rio. Last week, Pastor Rodrigo, thanks for stepping in, and talented guy, able to teach, a play, lead worship, does many things here in the church. He preached, and you can catch his sermon on YouTube. Tuesdays, we post the Sunday morning service. At night, we post UC University with Sam Sawyer, our core classes here, doctrinal classes. I invite you to watch the Freedom Trail. It's our weekly communion. I blended. This week was my first week back after being in the United States, and I was a little bit overwhelmed with just walking through the streets of Boston. I took my daughter on the Freedom Trail. And so this week, as I was journaling and thinking about time with family, my parents who are aging but in good health, relatively good health. My dad survived cancer last year. My mom got really sick with COVID, but we were out and about. They really blessed us. My sister, my brother, I got to see a wonderful time together. And this last weekly communion kind of blended the history of the United States that tells the freedom struggle and questions, where do human rights come from? Where is this necessity for justice or this indignation over injustice come from? So we're able to go back to the roots in America and see what's become of that and blend that with the freedom trail that we see in the scriptures, the Via Dolorosa, Christ's painful way, which brings true freedom to us. Today is third Sunday, and we're going to be celebrating birthdays. Anybody have a birthday here today? Or not today, but this month in June? It could be today. We're going to call you up soon. Yes, Hosanna did. When the kids leave, we're going to call you guys up and pray over you. And then I invite everybody over to Fellowship Hall. We're going to cut a cake and actually make some noise and sing for them. And so it's just an opportunity to honor others. The Bible says in Romans 10, a big part of the gospel is to not think so much of yourself, but honor others above yourselves. This July, we're going to have summer day camp. We're doing that in partnership with Reese School, Colonia Jafaria, summer day camp. And the registration is out. I brought some registration forms in the back table. Paulo is there. Paulo, do you see those forms there? Right where you are, there's some forms. If you have a child that's between 5 and 10, the neat thing about that is we have a group of teenagers coming down. They're going to be participating, doing English camp in the midst of that, and that's going to be wonderful. But you need to sign up because there's only 50 spots available. It'll be 2 weeks in a row, and our teenagers from the United States are going to be here in the second week. So go take a look at those details. We're going to try and get some of the older guys involved in coming out to that to translate and be with the high school kids who are coming down, all right? So talk to me afterwards. Shabazz, we want to get your boys involved there, all right? I like that beard, man. I'm going a little bit time. Look at that. Great, man. Next Sunday is our annual meeting. And very important that we have all of our UC members participate in that. And if you look in the bulletin, you can see it's posted and the agenda of that meeting, presentation of candidates, and we're going to be sharing, giving some different reports, but also sharing ministry opportunities for the coming year. And so very instrumental that all our members are here. And if you're a visitor or an attender, you can sit in on that and catch a vision and see why it's important to be a member as well. I think that's it for announcements. Why don't we stand up as we continue to worship the Lord Jesus in song?
The song we're going to sing now, we sang last year, but only once. So we can consider as a new song for the church, as we will sing the song for the next weeks, just for all of us to really learn how to sing it. What you can do, you've got wonders, your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again. 'Cause there's no reason wall you can't break through, no mountain you can move, all things are possible. There's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can save, all things are possible. The darkest night you with my heart fear, would you defeat it? How trust in you alone? 'Cause there's no reason wall you can't break through, no mountain you can move, all things impossible. There's no strong.
People said, what? All God's people said, amen. Please be seated. We're going to call our kids up here.
Jesus loved the little children, called the children of the world. Red, yellow, black, and white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loved the little children of the world. Jesus loved the see a precious in His sight. Jesus loved the little children of the world. Jesus loved the little children of the world.
Let's put the little ones over here so we can see you this way and this way, not behind. Yeah, you can go over there. That's great. Everyone together. Oh, come on back. Foosh you. Well, kids. Yeah, we're going to do that now. Yeah. So today is the third Sunday of the month. And here at Union Church, what we do on the third Sunday, anybody remember? We call all those who've had a birthday in these recent days. And I know there's a couple here, right here. Yeah. Spring chickens, right? Joe, come on down, man. Yeah. Yeah. Give him a hand. Any other June birthdays? Oh, wonderful. The whole family. Yeah. Great, 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 great. Well, let me pray. Lord, we give you thanks for life. We give you thanks for new life. And today we celebrate with Carla and Joe and Hosanna and others who will be celebrating one more year of life. We don't take it for granted these days. Our breath comes from you. Sustain them, Lord. Bless them, Lord, not only this month, but also for many more years. And may they know your goodness and grace all the days of their lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you guys have a great time. We may need a little help here with the kids because we got some little ones and big ones. Yeah. Oh, we have help. We have help lined up. All right. Let me give you guys a hug. And we're going to be having cake on the other side, all right? So after the service, want to join you guys all to join us for cake, and we're going to be singing to you, all right? So come over for a piece of cake in Fellowship Hall, and we're going to make a little noise over there and celebrate. If you're a member, if you're a visitor here today, you can register your presence with us on this card. Some of you with kids came in later. We have a registration for our summer camp. We're teaming up with Reese School. We got a team of Americans coming in. We put some registration forms out there, but also put it in the UC What's Up group. And some of you I know already have received that. So it's kind of, they have a limited amount of Vagas places, so I encourage you to sign up. You know, I always thought that Rio de Janeiro was the facelift capital of the world. Did you hear that? You know? Now, some people have told me I could use a little eye job there. I'm sagging, you know, I guess that's part of old age. I don't know. But according to the New Yorker, I was wrong. Did you know? So the United States has more plastic surgeries, do more plastic surgeries than any other country. But if you look at it per capita, how many surgeries compared to how many people, it's only six in the country's list. And Brazil is only number two. Ah, so then the question is, what country leads the world in facelifts? South Korea. Really? Yeah, that's what I said. Really? Pretty wild. Now listen to this. Truly, South Koreans put their money where their mouth is. We got to laugh, all right? A little bit corny. Some of you, where's Max? Put your money where your mouth is, all right? That's a slang when you're proud of something and you boast about it, right? You're confident in it. Someone might challenge you and say, put your money where your mouth is. So when I say Flamengo is going to beat the Fluminense, Cristiano Ribeiro might say to me, yeah, put your money where your mouth is. How much money do you want to put on that game, right? All right, well, here, literally, the South Koreans are putting their money where their mouth is, or maybe we can say where their mouth was, right? Because it was here and now it's up there, along with their nose and eyes and everything else. But what is true, we put our money where our confidence is, or we think we can buy confidence, right? With a younger face. So we have as many, studies show, as one in three women in Seoul will have a facelift. But the BBC, they did their own independent study. They found that half, 50% of all 20-somethings, young women in their 20s, between 20 and 30, get a facelift. Wow. Now, why is that? It's got to be driven by a deep belief, right? And so in this case, I think the belief is that if you have a facelift when you're young, in your 20s, that the work will carry you through old age, okay? And that's a society that puts a lot of effect on physical appearance and youthfulness. Now, men, before you just look at the women, 15% of the men get involved in that market as well. And today, the Apostle Paul is teaching in our text what is truly important about life, about the divine life. And guess what? It's rooted in belief. Belief. But the question is, what is the object of that belief? A belief in God that is manifested by a youthful, childlike faith. So instead of putting your confidence in a youthful face, the Apostle Paul is calling us to a youthful, childlike faith. So instead of a facelift today, and I know, I'm not going to say whether that's right or wrong, you know, it's very available out there. Some of you may even need a facelift, right? I'm not going to say that you necessarily do, but, you know, I'm not going to get in that debate. I'm smarter than that, you know. But some of you may need a facelift, but as your pastor, upon the authority of the scriptures, I'm going to tell you, suggest that everybody here this morning could use a facelift. Putting your confidence not in the flesh and an eternal fountain of youth, but putting your confidence in God, in His eternal promises and purposes. Now, maybe you've considered it. How many of you have considered a little plastic surgery, a little facial touch-up? Today, we're going to see that the Apostle Paul tells the story of an old man, saggy face, really two old men. He calls them to the witness stand in this ongoing court case we have, that have had a facelift, and they have put unwavering faith, not in their own strengths, but in the promises of God. Would you stand as we read our text today from Romans 4, verses 1 through 12. Actually, today we're just going to get through 8 verses, so we're going to read these 8 verses right now. And we'll have them up here on the screen, but I encourage you, if you have a Bible nearby, whether that's electronical or paper or bulletin, keep that by your side. Reading from Romans 4, starting at verse 1. What then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, discovered in this matter? If in fact Abraham was justified by works, he had something to boast about, but not before God. What the scripture said, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but as obligation. However, to the one who does not work, but trusts God, who justifies the ungodly, their faith is credited as righteousness. David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness of the one to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. Would you pray with me? Lord, we are thankful that you are so faithful to your word and to your promise. We are thankful that our confidence doesn't have to come from our own strength or our eternal outward beauty, but in something much more fixed, something eternal, something that started long ago and will continue. Father, I pray that you would open up the scriptures to us now that we might understand this mystery between faith and righteousness. Would you do that so we leave here more confident, more joyful, more restful, having been standing on the very promises of God? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Well, our very first words here begin this way: what then shall we say? So already he's pulling us back to remember what he just said, right? So it makes us go back, and we're looking at Romans 3:28. So it's been a couple weeks since we've been on this series, and the Apostle Paul had just made this bold declaration in chapter 3, verse 28, says, "For we hold that one is justified by faith, apart from works of the law." And we're continuing on this series, right? The power of the gospel, not only, but also. And again, if you missed Sam's last preaching on that in that chapter, very important because we're starting to transition, all right? And I'm going to tell you about that in a minute. So if you want to follow along where we're going, you have to kind of see where we've been. So you can get on to YouTube and Union Church Rio and check those messages out. If you remember well, Paul's letter to the church in Rome starts by declaring two things. What did he declare in part one, right in the beginning of this book? The righteousness of God was being revealed, and the wrath of God was being revealed. The wrath of God, we spent five Sundays. It was chapter 1, verse 18, all the way through 3:20. Wow. And Paul has transitioned from that wrath and sin in part one to salvation in part two. And he does that with this bold declaration: one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Now, again, Paul's literary style here, he's trying as he writes to this church to kind of create a courtroom scene, all right? And it's complete with an arraignment, it has an indictment, and there'll be a verdict. And all humanity has been arraigned, brought in before the judge, right? The judge and the jury, who are who? God. He is both judge and jury. And the indictment is that all have sinned. Well, who are all? Well, you have the non-religious people, the pagan people, the partiers that say we don't want to know about God. We have the religious people, right? Those who try to follow a God in their own strength. And then he includes both Jew and himself as a Christian. Really, in humanity, the indictment is for all. There is none righteous, no, not one. There's none who seek God. All are condemned by their own wickedness and ungodliness, apart from the grace of God and through faith in Christ. Now, the good news of all this gospel is that God is not only the judge and the jury, but he's also the defense lawyer and savior, all right? And the good news of this message is that we who are condemned can rest. Ah, we can trust. Ah, Christ for our redemption. We don't have to try and guess, did I do enough good works? We don't have to try and figure it out. It's not so complicated. Now, it's not easy, but it's certainly not complicated. You don't really have to do anything except believe. Now, Paul, being a Jew, he knows that there's those in the church, they're listening to this and they're skeptical. They rise the eyebrow, right? They're not going to take this without a little debate. And most likely, they're the Jewish section of the church because they have their hero, Abraham, who was chosen by God to be the father of the Jews. And they believed at this time, the time of Abraham, and maybe still do today, that God distinctly chose Abraham because of his works, because of his faithfulness, because of what he has done, because of his obedience. In other words, God chose Abraham because he was the best of the best. He was the MVP of the humankind, right? A model for us all to follow. The Maccabees, a book in the Apocrypha and other literature, lots of Jewish literature, you can find sightings where was not Abraham found faithful in temptation and it was reckoned unto him for righteousness. And even our own Bible, we see lots of evidence that might point to really what saved Abraham was his own faithfulness. But that's not the case that Paul is bringing before the church in Rome. Here's the point. If Abraham was justified by good works, then all humanity can be. But if Abraham could not be, then no one else can be. So now back to our courtroom scene. And here in a dramatic moment after this indictment, Paul decides to call up a witness to the stand. He looks out amongst the folks present, and he says, who is he going to call up here, you know? And everyone's kind of nervous. Oh, what are they going to say about me? And he calls up no other than Abraham himself, all right? So we see that through Abraham's testimony and what Paul is going to share, that God's revealed righteousness that he's talking about in the New Testament in this gospel is not a new thing at all. But it has old historical roots and it's rooted in the Old Testament. And this righteousness of God come down has always been accredited by faith and not by works. And let's just say there's a beauty of discovery in the Bible. It's just amazing how it touches the human soul. Again, this is a great church because we have, not great in number, but we have people from all walks of life, all different countries, but we all are united on Christ, in Christ. It touches our soul and the beauty of discovery that God's righteousness and justification by faith was already present in the Old Testament serves to flourish and nourish our confidence, not in ourselves and our own pride that we would boast, no, but in God and his promises that they're not new, they're everlasting. And certainly confidence in the unity of the scriptures in the Bible. So who is it? It's Abraham to the stand. And we read about Abraham in this testimony in Romans 4, verses 1 through 3. And he continues to say, what then shall we say? That Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, discovered in this matter, that is the matter of being righteous through faith, justified through faith, If, and that's a big if you see the word if, then what's coming? Then, right? If, in fact, Abraham was justified by works, then he had something to boast about, but not before God. Now, Paul repeats over and over again this theme of boasting. What is boasting linked to? And I talked about it a little earlier when I talked about my team, you know, our pride and our confidence. And Paul always links boasting with religious people's works. So we can see how we measure up to the next guy, the next gal. But emphatically, he declares here, no way. No one can boast. Certainly not before God. And then he immediately goes into the scriptures. I love this. Verse 3. What does scriptures say? That's why we're a Bible-based church. In our leadership meetings, what we try to do is open up the scriptures. And if we're talking about an issue, we need to say, not just what we think the church should do, but what do the scriptures say? And I think we're doing better at that. Opening up the scriptures. What do the scriptures say? Our small groups. You want to do something, you have a discussion about something. Don't be lazy. Open up the scriptures. What do the scriptures say? Oh, they do. Where does it say that? Oh, I'm not sure where it says it, but it says it somewhere. Well, that wouldn't be so convincing in court, would it, Paulo? Well, the scriptures say this. But Abraham, he goes to a specific Old Testament scripture about a figure who is known as the father of a nation. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. He says nothing about Abraham's obedience here, just his belief. Nothing about him leaving his country in faithfulness, only belief. And Paul cites this from Genesis chapter 15, verses 5 and 6, this very, very warm and beautiful context between God and his chosen man. Genesis 15, verse 5. If you want to open your Bibles, we're going to come back to this. Genesis chapter 15, verses 5 and 6. And he, God, he brought Abraham outside and said, look toward heaven and number, count the stars, if you are able to number them. And then he said to Abram, so shall your offspring be. Well, here's the context of that. God had already made a covenant with Abraham back in chapter 12, declaring blessing to Abraham. I will bless you. And God promised that Abram, and he wasn't Abraham, we're used to calling him Abram. Back in that time, it was Abram, that Abram would be the father of a great nation. In fact, his name, Abram, you know what it means? Exalted father. But some years now have passed, and we come up to this chapter in 15. Abram is now in his mid-80s. Maybe as many as 11 years. He was 75 when he was told. He had no children up to 75. His wife already in advanced years. No son. Now imagine all your life, your name is Exalted Father. Hello, Exalted Father. Hello. Hello, Exalted Father. Hello. And you have no kids. It's kind of, you get picked on that kind of stuff. You'd think you'd pick up like, just call me Abe, you know, something like that. Exalted Father. Hi, Exalted Father with no kids. You know. But God says, so these stars are your descendants will be. What is Abraham's response to God? 86 years old, exalted father, no kids. Now he's promised descendants as numerous as the stars. What is the response from Noah? Simple. It's a very simple text, great and direct for a court case. Genesis 15:6. And Abram believed the Lord. Now the Hebrew word for believe is emunah. Emunah, which is where we get our word amen. Amen was the response, the simple response of belief, so be it, we translate it into, when God told this barren man that your descendants shall be as the stars. And he simply responded in belief, amen. Wow. And God, Genesis 15:6, and God credited it to him as righteousness. Now, some might even say, object to this by saying, well, in a sense, Abraham's faith, his belief is work, and he deserves salvation by his own merit of faith. So, like, you rejected Christ, but you accepted Christ, so that's a work of faith, so really you deserve, God owes you. But Paul brings up this issue in Galatians 2:16 when he says this, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ. And he alludes to the faith of Jesus Christ. Even we have believed in Jesus that we might be justified by the faith of Christ, not by the works of the law, for the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. You know, really, our faith is an open conduit. It's not work in which the grace of God can come in and touch our hearts. Faith is even a gift. Romans 4, verses 4 and 5. Now, this is our text. To the one who works, wages are not credited as a gift, but they're obligations. So if I make a contract with you and you come and work 8 hours and I promised you 100 AIs, it's not a gift if I give you 100 AIs. That's what we'd agreed on. However, to the one who does not work, no work, we'd say that guy's lazy, right? No work, but trust God who justifies who? The ungodly. Their faith is credited as righteousness. Now, this is heavy because here's the dagger. So then who does God justify? Does he justify the faithful? Does he justify the righteous? Or does God justify the wicked? However, to the one who does no work, nothing but trusts in God, who justifies who? The ungodly, the sinner, the condemned. Their faith is credited as righteousness. And 11 times Paul will repeat this phrase that faith is credited as righteousness into your account. And the very word is a banking term. It's a financial term. Now you and I have a financial, not a financial, that a moral debt before God. No work can pay it off. You and I have a debt. We wake up, look in our account, and you say, God, I'm going to work this off over the rest of my life. I'm going to parcelado, eh? And it doesn't work that way. You can't do it. You'll never pay that debt. But the good news, the jury judge, he's also the defense lawyer's savior. And he pays your debt for you a vista. Christ died once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. So he died for Abraham, who lived in faith, to one who would come from his very seed. And he dies for you and me today who look back 2,000 years to Calvary, the blood that was shed, so that when you wake up in the morning through faith, you no longer have debt, because all your sin and iniquity has been transferred to Jesus' account. So it wasn't the nails, but our account being transferred, deposited, and he took it and he paid it, a vista, once for all. So that his righteousness, when he rose from the dead, could be transferred into your account. Therefore, you who are better than I am, and I am better than he is, we have nothing to boast about, though we may, but never before God. This is the good news of the gospel, and what we can have only through faith and belief. And the good news, it's not based on you. It's not based on my ability, but based on his and what he has done, what he did. Our justification is always, always, always for the glory of God. It's for our good, but always for his glory, that we might not boast. But if we do boast, it would be in one thing and one thing and only, and that is the cross of Christ. And our boasting would be transferred or transformed into praise, because our justification is for his glory. Isaiah 43:22 is probably the pinnacle or high point of salvation by grace in the Old Testament. And the Lord says this, I, even I, am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and remember your sins no more. Now, for me as a pastor preaching here at the church every week with Sam, going through these books of the Bible and talking through the themes, the principles, the declarations, the one that has really impacted my life as a Christ follower these recent years, giving me confidence in God and joy in being in the pulpit, is the number of times that the Old Testament repeats this phrase, for my name's sake. God referring to himself as the one who fulfills his promises. He is the one who fulfills the covenant. He is the one who fulfills his loving purposes for his own glory and for his own name's sake. I know I can rest. He's got this. Yes, Abraham did exhibit great faith, and we're going to see that next week. All the ways that Abraham's faith is a model for our faith, and all the works that it did produce, and all the types of works that genuine belief will produce in the believer. But it is never your justification before the Lord. Here Paul mentions that this spiritually bankrupt Abram, who has been arraigned and indicted for his wickedness and ungodliness, with all the rest of humanity, is declared righteous, justified, right in God's eyes. He is the man. He will be the father of a nation, with a one-word response. Amen, Lord. So not only did Abraham receive a reward for work he didn't do, But also David, King David, who they loved, didn't receive condemnation and judgment that he did deserve. And we may look at that as the other half of mercy and grace in the Old Testament. So now Paul calls up his, okay, Abraham, you're dismissed. We'll get back to you. Don't go anywhere, you know. David, come up here. And now we see in Romans 4, 6 through 8, Abraham brilliantly will quote Psalm 32, David's own words, when he says, David says the same thing when he speaks of the blessedness, the same blessedness that Abraham shared. Blessed are you, the blessedness of the one to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Verse 7, blessed are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord will never count against them. Well, this morning, I want to conclude trying to focus on the object of our faith, or the object of our belief, and that is God. And it's kind of hard to do because faith is trusting what we cannot see. God, we cannot see. But if we were there with Abraham on that starry night, that was something, wasn't it? How many of you can remember a time you were in a dark place and the stars were shining and you kind of lose your breath and you can actually see the Milky Way, the Via Láctea, né? It's just a blur of lights, right? Well, let's go back to that starry night. I'm going to create it right here for us, and this is what we're going to close with, this object lesson. God brought him outside. He said, look toward heaven and number, count the stars if you can, if you're able. Then he said, so shall your offspring be. Have you ever considered the vastness of our solar system? The speed of light, for you engineers out there, what is the speed of light in miles per hour, miles per second? 186,000 miles per second. That's the equivalent of being 300,000 kilometers per second, all right? 300,000. What does that even mean? That means that if I was traveling the speed of light, I would travel 7.5 times around the earth in 1 second. Now, how long does it take to travel from Houston to Rio in a plane? That's not bad, right? I mean, that beats than taking a boat. Unless you're on a cruise, that's pretty good. But 10 hours, right? But light is speeding at traveling at 300,000 kilometers per hour. I need some volunteers up here. Would you come up here? Victor, Sam, come on up here. Hosanna, would you like to help? It's your birthday month. Come on up here. Americo, come on up here. I'm going to pull this over. Everybody over on this side here, I'm wondering, I don't know where Rodrigo is. I'm going to get in trouble for this. We're going to be off camera. And if we run up the middle or run out that side door, I guess we can do that. But here's what we're going to do. Why don't you guys come over on this side? Now, this is a scaled down model of our solar system. I don't know if you can see this. Right here, there's a little knot. It's blue. All right, and right next to it, the distance of my thumbnail is a yellow ball, and that's the moon, okay? Now, traveling at 300,000 kilometers per hour, it would take 1.7 seconds to go from the Earth to the moon. Now, if we go and see where the sun would be, the sun's quite a bit larger, and it's a little less than a meter away, okay? Traveling 300,000 kilometers per second, how many minutes would it take to get out to the sun? 8 minutes, more or less. Excellent. That's right. 8 minutes. Okay. So now our solar system goes out this way to the great beyond. Who's closest with me here? Sam, why don't you walk this out? Take that knot. Grab that knot. That's your reference. And yeah. Whoa. Okay. Just walk that to where, let this down. And just hold that up. Don't pull me out of the pulpit there. Okay, good. So right where that knot is, that is Mars, okay? And in our scale, that's where Mars would be. And that's 18 minutes, almost 19 minutes away, traveling 300,000 kilometers per second, all right? Now, Saturn, come over here, Hosanna. Now, you're going to grab... that next knot. There's an always look for the knot. Go in front of Sam. You guys don't get tangled up. Sam, come on this side. So good. Thank you, brother. All right, stretch that out there. Okay, and you guys start walking out that way. Now, Saturn, we got to go. I'm not sure. Actually, you should be where Hosanna is. Sam, take Hosanna's. Hosanna, you're going to go out, you're going to find the 8-meter mark, okay? So the very next one's 8 meters, and that, there it is. You see it? There it is. Keep going, all right? So that's Saturn, okay? Saturno, okay? And that is just over an hour that we're driving now. That takes us an hour to get there, driving how fast? 300,000 kilometers per second. Wow, we drive 1 hour, all right? Now we need to go out to 22 meters. So, why don't you come back this way? That's right, go ahead there, Victor. Find that next. I think there may be one more knot there. All right, so... if you don't find it, that's okay. Stand out there somewhere. 22 meters. It's like 60-some feet, so you're probably still... there it is. All right. So now we're flying out there, right? And flying at our speed of 300,000 kilometers, that's going to take us just shy of 3 hours flying, all right? And now who's left? All right, you can just stay there because the next one is Pluto, and that's another 16 meters, would be out, all right? So we're talking Pluto's, if this was straight, we'd be at the stairwell of the church, okay? 5 hours and 20 minutes. Now, here's the million-dollar question. Not that I'm going to give a million question. That stars that Abraham looked at, it's not the sun's not there, it's nighttime. He's looking at the Milky Way. Where would you put the nearest star? We're looking at the moon. Here's our bright moon, and we see the sun. Where would you see Abraham's stars that God was talking about? The nearest star. No, on this here. How far from the earth is it? When you look at the stars at night, are they before the moon? Are they after the moon? Listen to this. Now remember, Pluto's there. 5 hours and 20 minutes, driving 300,000 kilometers per second, 36 meters. Alpha Centauri would be 320 kilometers. We'd have to take by a lot more rope. You would have to get in the car and drive almost to São Paulo at this scale, with this rope. And guess how long it would take you to get to that first closest star? 4.2 years, light years, traveling 300,000 kilometers per second. That's the closest star. Now, what's the furthest part of the galaxy? Driving 300,000 kilometers per second would take you 100,000 years just to get to the end of the Milky Way. Now you say, what does all this mean? Now, the Milky Way is one of, some say, billions of galaxies, right? And some astronomers, as of late, said, we've searched them all, and God's not there. There's no God. But this is what the scriptures teach us when we consider our solar system and the universe. What could be bigger than that, right? What could be possibly bigger than this? And that's why people say God doesn't exist, because he doesn't exist within this space, within this matter, within this time. But God, through revelation, says this. God sees the number of stars, and he gives them all their names. Great is our Lord, and great is his power, and there is no limit to his wisdom. Now, I want you to do this. Go like this with your hand and count the rungs on the roof there. 1, 2, 3, 4, all right? This, in Bible times, is called a span, all right? And you can, they could navigate, they could count distances with a span. Isaiah 40, 12 says this about our Lord. God Almighty, who has measured the waters of this earth in the palm of his hand and the heavens or the universe in one span. God is outside the universe. He is outside time. He is outside material. And all that we can barely conceive us fits him within one span. Now, we know God is not physical, but it tells us here of how great God is, how deep his wisdom and how far it goes. But then the most wonderful thing is this. He's powerful. He's all-knowing. But does he really care? And the psalmist says, David himself, when he was plagued with sin and his own wickedness, he says to the Lord, when I look at your heavens, maybe thinking of Abraham out there, the works of your fingers, the moon, the stars, which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of him, or the Son of Man that you even care? Yet you have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You have given him dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all these things under his feet. When God wanted to create something more like himself than anything else, it wasn't the moon, it wasn't the sun. Yeah, they were little governors. But he created you. He created me. He created us, humankind, to reflect his goodness, to be his representative. Sin, rebellion, is an overwhelming problem for each of us. I don't know what your problem is. You don't have to tell me. Some like to, and you know, it's good to have somebody you can share your burdens with. But God is bigger than your sin. God is bigger than your problem. And he credits his righteousness to those who believe. Let's pray. Lord, who are we that you should care for us? But you have set this all in place. You have started time. You have created material. You've created a space that we might know your glory. And when we rebelled against it and didn't represent you well, you came not only as judge to show righteousness, but also as Savior. Thank you for Jesus, that he walked this earth. Thank you that you took our sin and credited it to his account. Thank you that you took his righteousness and credit to our account. I pray for each one who is suffering under the burden of sin, a stronghold, O Lord, chained, captive. Lord, may we look to you and lay it at your feet in only need to believe that you are the one who justifies the wicked. Would you do that in such a way that it bursts open something new, your spirit comes alive in our and creates something new, a joy to be released from those things that held us down. That means we might walk in faithfulness as a testimony, as Abraham and David were. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close our service today with our tithes and offerings. And this is not one way to appease God. Don't jump right back into righteous works. If I give an extra donation today to the Lord, He's going to wipe out that thing. No. But in fact, through belief and trusting in Christ for forgiveness of your sins, guess what happened? A burden's gone. And then all of a sudden, we feel more free to give because we know we can trust. If He would die for my sins, if God did not withhold His own Son, how will He not graciously give us, along with Him, the things that we need? So Genesis 14 says this, "Then Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was a priest of the Most High, and he blessed Abram, saying, 'Blessed be Abram by God Most High, creator of heaven and earth, and praise to be to God Most High, who delivered your enemies into your hand.' Then Abram gave him a tenth of everything." Abraham believed God. Let's stand as we continue worship by singing and through our tithes and our offerings.
Water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond a galaxy. You are.
God of wonders beyond a galaxy.
Stars tonight, we'll see them in a different light. You are holy, and through faith and belief, you have credited that holiness into our accounts. May we sing your praise. Lord, thank you for these gifts. Thank you and bless the giver of the gift, for they truly know your grace. Would you multiply it that we might continue to proclaim the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, one more time, I'd like to invite you all to join me to my right here, Fellowship Hall. I guess that's your left, and we're going to cut the cake and sing some happy birthday to some special folks today. And let me send you out now with 1 Corinthians 1:3. Church, grace in peace to you in the name of the Father and through the Lord Jesus Christ. Go in peace. God, one that's beyond our